More about falling film evaporators, coming up in this webinar. Welcome to this webinar with the title An Improved Understanding of Falling Film Evaporators Operation in Cane Sugar Factories. My name is Andreas Lehnberger and I am Senior Manager of the R&D Department at BMA in Germany. Together with my colleague Omkar Tawal, we have prepared this presentation for the ISCT conference in Hyderabad in February 2023. In our presentation, we start with some background information. After an historical outline of the falling film evaporator development, we will state some facts about heat transfer that are particularly relevant for falling film evaporators. The main chapter deals with the operation of these evaporators in cane sugar factories. First, let us understand the impact of some issues on the operation of the falling film evaporators before we look at scaling and cleaning, the energy requirement of the sugar production process and how falling film evaporators enhance these will be outlined. At the end, we focus on the sucrose losses before concluding the presentation with a personal statement. Let us jump into the historical outline of the trickle film evaporator development. In 1844, Robert Rieu developed a multi-effect evaporator system for the Louisiana sugar industry. The driving force for this development was the improved energy efficiency. You know, at that time, only Robert evaporators were state of the art. Some years later, a first test of an evaporator with falling trickle film has been done in the beet sugar industry. And the driving force for this development was the enhancement of the heat transfer. Compared to Robert evaporators, a falling film evaporator has only a very low hydrostatic head of the liquid because of the thin film. And unfortunately, this test failed in the beet sugar industry. This was especially because of not proper juice distribution and of scaling of the tubes. Some years later, the Kästner evaporator was developed, like shown here on the right side on the picture. Jumping forward on the timeline, in the 1960s, the falling film evaporators became state of the art in the beet sugar factories. The decisive factors for this development were the improving automation of the cane sugar, of the beet sugar production, and the possibility to clean with high pressure water jet. And about 30 years ago, there were the first trials of the tubular falling film evaporator in a cane sugar factory. At that time, the potential of the use of the falling film evaporators has been recognized also for the cane sugar factories because the falling film evaporators were state of the art in the beet sugar factories. From this historical outline, I would like to go over to a technological view to the falling film evaporator and especially to the heat transfer in the falling film evaporator. You see on the right side of the picture a tube detail. There's in the center, there's a tube wall. On the left side, heating steam coming to the outside of the tube. And on the right side, inside of the tube wall, inside the tube, the liquid is flowing down and vapor is produced from the surface of the liquid. We have a heat flux from the heating steam side to the vapor side. And with this heat flux and the different resistances, heat transfer resistances, a temperature profile is forming. This temperature profile has a higher temperature at the heating steam side and a lower temperature at the vapor side. We have to take care about the boiling point elevation, delta theta L, that is on the right side on the bottom. And there can be figured out the effective temperature difference between heating steam and vapor, especially between heating steam and the liquid temperature at the surface, which is then the effective temperature difference for the heat transfer from heating steam to vapor. To figure out the quantity of heat and the efficiency, there is a heat transfer coefficient defined. And this heat transfer coefficient, I think you know that, is a heat flow divided by the surface area and the temperature difference. The local heat transfer coefficient is a combination of the heat transfer on the heating side, alpha cont, the heat conductivity through the wall, and the heat transfer on the liquid side, alpha L. In order to have an idea on the values of that specific heat transfer coefficients, I have written down there on the below the diagram the values for the, especially for the heating steam side, that is 12,000 to 18,000 watt per square meter and Kelvin. For the conductivity through a stainless steel tube with 1.5 millimeters, it's 10,000 watt per square meter and Kelvin. And on the liquid side, we have a large range for the liquid side for heat transfer coefficient, that is from 700 to 10,000 watt per square meter and Kelvin. You see that especially the liquid side heat transfer coefficient is relevant for the local heat transfer coefficient. We have done a detailed analysis on the flow regime on the Jewish side. So the Jewish side, it's not a laminar flow, it's a laminar wavy flow, or at higher flow rates, it's a turbulent flow of the trickle film. Following that, with that flow regime, we can figure out values and dependencies of the heat transfer coefficient from other values. And outcoming from this survey is that the minimum overall heat transfer coefficient, so this is a heat transfer coefficient from the beginning, from the top of the tube down to the bottom of the tube. This is depending on the viscosity of the liquid, eta. K is 170 divided by the viscosity eta times 0.333. The company GIA has made measurements on a falling film tube, and they came a very similar formula. This also depends on the viscosity with a very similar exponent. So that is the falling film evaporators HTC, and let us look to now to some more details of operation. If we have our heat transfer from heating steam to vapor, the value of the HTC is only valid if the temperature profile is uninhibited. This means on the heating steam side, there may be some non-condensable gases which are coming into the system. For example, by air leakages, if we are under vacuum, or from the juice, which is entering the first effect evaporator. The non-condensable gases, they collect themselves in the heating chamber. They reduce the partial water pressure and the condensing temperature, and so they reduce the relevant or the effective temperature difference. To give you an idea how sensitive this is, as a thumb rule, 1% of non-condensable gases, this refers to approximately 0.25 Kelvin of temperature reduction. So And proper removal of non-condensable gases is very, very essential. And this is done via the vent pipes of the falling film evaporator. And of course, you have to take care not to have too much non-condensable gases in the heating steam. The non-condensable gases from the first, from the juice that you cannot influence, that is solved there in the juice, and this is released to the vapor during evaporation. But air leakages must be avoided, especially if you run the system under vacuum. And second part of inhibition of the heat transfer temperature profile is on the juice side, scale forming. You know and you experience very well that scale inhibits the heat transfer. And the scale, you know, also is coming from the impurities from the clear juice. And by heating up and concentration, the scale is forming on the heating surface. And this is done without any difference for each evaporator. Maybe Robert evaporator, Kästner evaporator, falling film evaporator, and even on surfaces of heat exchangers. On the right side on the diagram, we made some survey on the heat transfer of a first effect falling film evaporator. This falling film evaporator was operated about 1 month. And with a heat conductivity of the scale of 1 watt per meter in Kelvin, we figured out the thickness of the scale in the falling film evaporator. And what we found is there is a linear increase of the scale thickness with the time, and there is a figure of 0.012 millimeters per day, which is the scale increasing. This figure and is depending on the position of the evaporator in the evaporator station. So other effects have a different slope of increasing the scale, depending, of course, on the composition of the juice coming in and the temperature differences and the temperature levels in the different bodies. With comparison to literature, published papers, and so on, we found that for robot-type evaporators, this is very similar to that result we have here in our survey on this falling film evaporators. So in our conclusion, we have not a difference to robot evaporators. Cleaning of the scale is necessary. And this depends on the position and the size of the falling film evaporator. For example, in the first effect, there is a possibility for necessity to clean, especially once a month, and on the final effect on a weekly basis. The pictures on the right side, you see in the white scaling on the top, this is more in the first effect, and the brown on the bottom picture, this is more on one of the last effects. And there is a difference in the aspect and also in the chemical composition of the scale. So for each effect, you have adjust the cleaning regime for the, especially regarding to the composition of the scale. We recommend for the first effect a chemical cleaning alkaline, or if it's necessary, alkaline, acidity and alkaline regime. And with this, it's very easy to remove all the scale from the evaporator's heating surfaces. For the final effect, it's a little bit more difficult to remove the scale only by chemical cleaning. This is sometimes additionally done with high pressure water jet, but with a combination of chemical cleaning and high pressure water jet, the heating surfaces will be clean as in the first before the first application. Of course, if we use the correct additives for the cleaning procedure, so that is more facilitating the cleaning and gives you some benefit in the timeline of cleaning. So at the end, by experiment at sites and experience at sites, you have to individually adjust the cleaning at the evaporators. Again, comparing that experience to the experience at the robot evaporators, we found that the cleaning procedure remains very, very similar to that you know from robot evaporator stations cleaning. I jump to the next topic, and that is the energy requirement of the sugar production process. This is a hot topic in current discussion. We would like to minimize the steam demand for the sugar production process. On the one side, we would like to have additional revenue from making power and selling that to the grid or to use bagasse as a raw material for other industry. The second point is, of course, the reducing of the greenhouse gas footprint, which is necessary to have a sustainable world and reducing the global warming. I have to state that falling film evaporators are not saving energy, but they are an important part for realizing the concepts. 10 years ago, we have already published on the IWSCC conference a paper which shows the steam demand of an Indian sugar factory which is fully equipped with falling film operators. This factory is operating, or at that time operated, the plants with Vapor 3. And as a result, the steam demand was 30% on cane with clean surfaces. Previous, there was a steam demand of 36% on cane, so the reduction in steam demand was 20%. With the time of 3 weeks of operation, the steam demand increased up to 33% on cane, and this was due to the scaling during that time. 3 years later, at the next IWSCT conference, we presented an upgrade of that plant. At that plant, a continuous panel VKT started operation on Vapor 4. And with that installation, the reduction of steam demand was additionally down to 28% on cane, again with clean surfaces for comparison. At that time, only 50% of the bagasse was used for sugar production, and the surplus bagasse was used for additional earnings, in this case, especially for power generation and delivery of the power to the grid. Sucrose losses. This is a discussion which has been arised in the cane sugar factories from the first idea of using falling film operators. You know that the sucrose losses result from sucrose inversion, which is mainly accelerated by high temperature, low pH, and a long residence time. Compared with robot evaporators, the falling film evaporator stations, especially for energy efficient cane sugar factories, has a higher temperature level. And so the discussion was that with a higher temperature level, we will have higher sucrose losses in falling film evaporator stations. So we made excessive surveys on sucrose losses in a falling film evaporator station. And we figured out that there is of course, in sucrose losses, and the 86% of the sucrose losses occurred in the first and second effect. And compared to the figures which are found in the publications, there is no difference to robot evaporators in the, for this case. There is a survey, there are several measurements in the literature available, which are on the shown here on the table on the right side. And if you look to the falling film evaporators, we measured the falling the sucrose losses to an amount of 0.22% on dry substance. If we compare this to other types of evaporator station, for example, for the Kästner in the, with the first effect and the other bodies, robot evaporators, there is a 2 times higher sucrose losses affecting in that installation than in the installation we have made the measurements. And if we go back to the robot evaporators, which form entirely the evaporator station, then there are sucrose losses measured which are 4 times higher than we have measured for the falling film evaporator station. So it's not true that the falling film evaporator station have higher sucrose losses due to a high temperature. It's clear that the falling film evaporator station have a very short residence time, and this reduces the sucrose losses effectively. And it's a really high difference from the, if you compare this to robot evaporators. At the end, your benefit for reduced sucrose losses results in a higher sugar production. You have a lower molasses quantity, and if you calculate that, you will have a quick return of investment if you invest in falling film evaporators. I would like to come now to the conclusion, and I would like to summarize. We have seen that in the last year and decades, there have been done a lot of laboratory industrial studies with falling film evaporators in cane sugar factories. And this technology is already state and has been state of the art in beet sugar factories. And with this studies, the specific issues into cane sugar factories has been now well understood and figured out. We see that the tubular falling film evaporators are becoming now an accepted alternative technology to robot evaporators. And this is especially because of the high heat transfer coefficient, especially at the high viscosity. Then the ability to operate the falling film evaporators at low temperature differences. And at the end, with reduction of the sucrose losses, with a short residence time of the juice. We also recognize that the cane sugar factories are now adopting the FFE technology. And with the use all over the world of falling film operators, the scaling and cleaning of the falling film operators have been now experienced, and this is working. And the sucrose degradation in the apparatus is now figured out and are lower. If we can place our own expectations, we expect that the increasing level of automation permits now the use of falling film apparatus as state of the art in the cane sugar factories, and the tubular falling film evaporators would usually be the first choice as for energy efficient cane sugar factory in the world. I would like to thank all the people who have been in discussion and the factories which has allowed us to make the surveys. So without this scientific community, it will be not possible to have this conclusion and this development for falling film evaporators. Thank you for your attention. Please comment below if you have any question or feedback. Thank you.